our live stream for this evening. This is orientation live stream number two for the season. This is living and dining on campus. So I am joined by some of our most popular folks on campus today. I'll let them introduce themselves in just a second. Again, my name is Josh Thompson, Director of New Student Orientation. We are thrilled to have you here today. Please go ahead and start thinking of questions you may have for folks within Catamount Dining and residential living. But we'll start with Eric. Eric, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Hey, how are we doing? My name is Eric Raymond. I am the Director of Operations here at Catamount Dining. Be 4 years this July that I've been here, and I absolutely love it out here.
And Margaret.
My name is Margaret Downs, and I am the Marketing Coordinator and the Consultant Registered Dietitian with Catamount Dining. I'm fairly new. I've been in their program since January, but I've actually worked at Western for about 7 years. So I've been here a while and absolutely love Catamounts.
Thank you, guys. Now on to our residential living side. We'll start with a man who probably needs no introduction, Mr. Brian Boyer.
Good evening. My name is Brian Boyer, and I'm a residential case manager with the Department of Residential Living. And in about a week and a half, I will have been here 18 years and doing this particular job for 10 years.
Thank you, Brian.
And I'm Bryant Barnett. I'm Executive Director of Residential Living. I just started my 18th year. I was also a student here, so I kind of came and never left. So certainly think that Cullowhee is a great place. So thanks for joining us.
I thank all of our panelists for being here. Thank you for joining us today as well. So if this is your first live stream, or if you're an old veteran, remember to send all of your questions in. They'll get filtered to me, and we'll get to them as quickly as we can. But first, we're going to start off and have our panelists just share with us any information or things they want the incoming student class to know about. Brian, let's start with you.
Sure. So first thing that I want to mention, and if you saw our live stream back in April, briefly mentioned it, but residential living is very excited to return to as close to normal as possible this fall. So that means that our common areas, much like you're seeing us in tonight, have been reset and they are ready for students to use. Our visitation policy will go back to a normal visitation policy. One of the things that we are excited about that we're kind of keeping from our COVID times is our staggered move-in. So you will be getting some more information about how move-in will go, but I can tell you now that it will start on Thursday, August the 12th, and Sunday through Thursday, we will have move-in times from 8 until 11:30, and from 1 until 4:30, and then on Fridays and Saturdays, we will add a later shift as well. So there will be more information coming about that, but overall, we're just really excited to get back to normal life in the residence halls, and we are looking forward to having you join us.
Brian, I appreciate breaking news on the orientation live stream. Students moving in a staggered move-in process starting on August the 12th.
Yes.
Thank you, Brian. Brian.
Unbelievably excited to be going back to as close to normal operations. We're really, really excited. Josh thought it would be helpful if I kind of described what a residential case manager does. So I often say my job title and I just get a blank look in response. Nobody knows what that means. But so there are two of us. There will be three at some point. We currently have a vacancy. But as case managers, it's essentially our job to try to get to know all the students, keep you happy, make sure you're having the best possible experience during your time here. So at orientation or on Facebook, you'll see, I give out my cell phone, my Snapchat, my Twitter, my Instagram, my Facebook, my email. And so if you have any problems, get in touch with one of us. It's very difficult to describe what a typical day looks like because it really just kind of depends on what you need as students. But again, primarily a residential case manager is designed to just make sure that you are having the best possible experience during your time here that you can have. And we will do whatever we can to make sure that you're happy.
Thank you, Brian. Margaret.
Yes, so I really just want to welcome everybody to Catamount Dining and let you know that Our best resource is dining.wcu.edu. And at that web address, you will be able to find meal plans, locations, and all the information that you're going to need to be able to register for your Catamount Dining meal plan and eating experience. So we share a lot of great information there. There are meal plans built for everyone. And so we look forward to welcoming you into your new home and being able to experience the life of food at Western Carolina University.
Thank you, Margaret. Eric.
Yeah, and to kind of echo what the Res Life team over here is saying, dining will be going back to as normal as possible. That means lots of indoor seating, serving on plateware, no more styrofoam. So that's a wonderful thing. The other thing is we are always hiring. Many, many positions available with flexibility to meet your class needs, life needs. So if you are looking for a little bit of extra income, you can actually text side hustle, one word, to 36000. And they will ask you actually what area you're looking for. You tell them Cullowhee, and then they'll send you a link right to all the positions available to work with us. We look forward to serving y'all and maybe even working with some of you. So thank you.
Thank you, Eric. Some great questions already coming in. So please continue to send questions in. We'll go right back to Catamount Dining. First question is for you guys. What dining and meal plan would you recommend for an off-campus student, particularly a junior transfer student?
Yeah, so I'll answer that. So any incoming transfer student in their residential, is that what you said, they're going to be
They're going to be off-campus.
Off-campus, so commuter. We definitely have several plans. Actually, you can buy any meal plan as a commuter. You can buy an unlimited meal plan, or you can buy block meal plans. We also have commuter declining balance plans. And so all of those options are definitely explained on our website, but any meal plan can be purchased by a commuter, and we encourage you to really look at that option because you're on campus and you're going to be here. So we have a 40 block plan, we have 80 block plans, and we have 150 block plans, which means for every 150 block, you get a meal swipe. And that can be used in our dining halls. It can also be used as what we call meal exchanges. So you have the option to eat at most of our locations, if not all of them, on a meal exchange. And I think the only location we don't have meal exchanges for is sushi for Gusto. But other than that, you can use those block exchanges anywhere. Unlimited plans also get unlimited access to both of our dining hall residential facilities, and that would be Courtyard Cafe and the Brown Lodge.
Thank you, Margaret. Next question is for our folks from residential living. How will early move-in for programs such as Project Care or Cat Camp be affected by the staggered move-in times this year?
So we will only consider folks who are arriving prior to August 12th as early arrivals. We are in conversations with folks of some of those other special programs, such as Cat Camp and various others across the campus, to work in making sure that we get folks signed up in the time slots that they are looking to move in. I know that in years past, we have some folks that have just tried to come in on, let's say, Thursday before classes begin. As an early arrival. And so now we will just encourage those folks to, as soon as we announce the move-in time slots are open, which that's going to be available on July 15th, that you'll need to log in and choose your move-in time based on when your program is asking. But you should receive lots of information from your program sponsor, so your university contact, that will explain to you if they have already taken care of getting you signed up for a move-in time, especially if it's prior to August 12th, or if they are going to be expecting you to log on and select your time from our available time slots.
Thank you, Brian. Our next question is again for our folks from residential living. It says, I'm 6'7". Nice for you, from a short guy. So it's hard for me to fit in a room or a typical twin bed. Is there anything special I need to request for that?
there is going to just be limited options for what we have. So all of our beds on campus are extra long twin beds. And so that's what's going to be in your room and going to be available. If you choose to bring your own bed for some reason, please know that the furniture, we request that the furniture that's in your room remains in your room. If you choose to take it out and store it, please know that you are responsible for it being there when you move out, which if you were to do a room change, that includes the middle of the year when you do the room change. And so that is an option, but please make sure that you are safely storing it and that it remains in the condition that it is in when you move in.
Thank you, Brian. Next question is for Eric. What are the different dining options on campus in terms of places to eat?
Well, first of all, I'd like to correct myself. I think earlier I said text to 36000. It's actually 63000. Side hustle for the job applications and things like that. As far as variety of dining, we have two all-you-care-to-eat facilities, the Courtyard Cafe, which is in the second floor of the Courtyard building, and then we have the Lodge at Brown, which is slightly different. You get to make one trip, and it's kind of an all-you-can-carry type of dining. We do have some retail locations, Freshens, Moe's, Panda Express, Witch Witch, Papa John's, Sushi with Gusto, Chick-fil-A, two Starbucks, Steak and Shake.
Catamount Eats.
And our Catamount Eats food truck. I think two Java Cities. I may have missed one or two there, but plenty of options. All the retail locations, if a meal plan you choose includes meal exchanges, you'll be able to use those at the retail locations. To hang on to your declining balance. And all of the dining hall facilities, Courtyard Cafe and the Lodge at Brown, accept all types of payment from your meal plan.
Thank you, Eric. Brian, next question is for you. Since my son hasn't received any information about choosing a dorm roommate, when should we expect that to come? And do you have any suggestions for meeting people or finding a roommate?
So as far as if you have not received any information, so if you have paid the housing deposit, the $150 non-refundable housing deposit, you should have received email to the student's Catamount email address. It will come from the address housingquestions@wcu.edu, and that encourages the student to go on and complete their residence hall agreement, which is the first step in that process. Then, once they complete that agreement, which is all an electronic signature format, then they will get another email, once again to their Catamount email address, that explains that then preferences are available for them to go on and make those choices. Do you want to talk about preferences?
Well, I was going to say, in terms of selecting a or finding a roommate, like what we strongly encourage you to do and what students typically do is really engage in our social media. And, you know, like our Instagram page, definitely want to highlight specifically our and students. Look, I know you're going to say Facebook is for old people. I get it. Facebook is the easiest, like, I mean, that's what they, I'm telling you. But Facebook is the easiest way for us to facilitate, like, kind of groups and, like, group messaging, things like that. So we are very active on Facebook. So I strongly recommend joining the WCU Class of 2025 Facebook page and engaging with other people that way. Again, that's WCU Class of 2025. And you will be able to indicate who you would like to live with. Like, you can select the roommate that you want to live with as long as it is mutual. Like, you have to make sure that if Bryant and I want to live, if I put down Bryant, but then Bryant says I don't want to live with him, then it doesn't happen. So it's just you have to make sure that it's mutual. And they would fill that request out.
You do that in those preferences that I was mentioning. So in those list of preferences are going to be roommate. It will be roommate matching questions if you don't have a specific roommate, your meal plan preference, your building preferences, all sorts of things. So, and I will circle back if you have not received that email through your Catamount email address, but you have paid the housing deposit, please reach out to our office. So 828-227-7303 or housingquestions@wcu.edu for email, and we'll be happy to take a look and see what is hanging up in that process. But those preferences are available until June 30th, and then we will take the site down and begin the process of making room assignments.
Thank you both very much. We have gotten several questions about individual groups and their move-in times. I'm going to refer you to for things like athletics and marching band and things like that. As Bryant mentioned previously, more information is going to be coming soon to your Catamount email address. Also, feel free to check in with your individual, whether it is a coach or whether it's the band director. Make sure you touch base with them on proper move-in procedures and how they'd like things to work as well. Moving on now, back to Catamount Dining. Are there any opportunities for mobile ordering? Is there an official app students can use?
Absolutely. It is called the Get app, G-E-T. And the Get app is kind of more than just a mobile ordering. You can manage your dining account. You can look up your transaction history. You can add declining balance there. But as you asked, yes, it also is a mobile ordering platform through all of our retail locations. Payments you can use as declining balance and meal exchange.
Thank you, Eric. Next question is about housing for in-person orientation. It says, my son has signed up for in-person orientation on 8/17. Would his move-in date be before then? And so as we've tried to let folks know, for in-person orientation that'll be taking place in August, the move-in process is not tied directly to your in-person orientation. So if you know you're coming in on the 17th, move-in starts on the 12th, make sure you try and sign up for a move-in date prior to the 17th so we can get you all moved in. If possible, or if you want to do two trips, you can do two trips. Again, that is completely up to your discretion at this point in time. Moving down the line with housing questions, if I've chosen to sign up for exclusively single dorm rooms, when can I expect my assignment?
So just know that requesting or preferencing a single residence hall room is completely fine, but there is no guarantee that we will have spots available when we get to you on the list. So the way that all of our housing assignments are made is based on the date that your housing deposit is paid. And so if there are more folks than we have private rooms requesting a private room, then we will fill those until we don't have any left, and then we will have to make preferences or meet preferences based on what we do have available. So no matter what you preferenced as the type of room that you wanted, we will send out room assignments following the last orientation. We typically shoot for mid to late July. Again, you'll notice a common theme. We communicate everything through your Catamount email address, so please make sure that you're checking that. We are trying our best each year to get those out as early as possible. So again, mid to late July, no matter what you preference, you will get your assignment, your roommate information, all of that on mid to late July. It will be before the move-in time slots open up, because those are based on your building as well.
I also strongly recommend, if you have indicated all private rooms, again, that is okay. You may want to, and Bryant, you can jump into it. You may want to make one of those preferences for a double room in a build. Like, basically, if I am requesting a private room and I've put all private rooms, but when the system tries to assign me a room and there's no private rooms left, the system now has no preference to go on, nothing. And so pretty much the computer is going to put me where it puts me. So do what you want, you know, do what you need to do, but I strongly recommend at least one of those options being for a double.
Thank you both very much. Next question is for our dining friends. When you say unlimited, does that truly mean unlimited?
Yes. So, and we have two options on an unlimited meal plan. One is our unlimited premium, and the other one is an unlimited basic. Those are both residential plans, but commuters can also purchase them. And what it means is that you have unlimited access to our dining halls, and that would be Courtyard Cafe and the Brown Lodge. And so whenever you're eating in those two locations, you have unlimited meal swipes.
Awesome. Thank you, Margaret. Next question is back over to housing. Do roommates have to be same sex?
They do. In North Carolina, we do have some requirements. And so roommates or suite mates who share a bathroom do have to be of the same sex.
Thank you, Brian. Next question is back to dining. How early will our meal plans be activated?
All meal plans should be active on August 12th, the first day of move-in.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Back across to housing. Can Honors College students live with non-Honors College students? Do all Honors College students have to stay in the same residence hall?
They do not, and that brings up a good point. So by all means, honors and non-honors students can room together. If they are looking for the honors experience or to be in Balsam Blue Ridge, we do treat Blue Ridge as our honors overflow. So that is where we specifically try to place honor students who want to live in the community but want to live with a non-honor student. By no means do honor students have to live in Balsam and Blue Ridge, and in fact, just because you're an honor student, we won't automatically put you in either of those buildings. You do need to preference it. So we certainly reserve space for honor students, but some folks choose that they're not interested in living in the community, and that's completely fine. Just know that if you do want to live in one of those two buildings, that you will need to preference either Balsam or Blue Ridge.
Thank you very much, Brian. Next question is for Catamount Dining. Can a student change their meal plan?
Yes, they can. They can actually change their meal plan up until a deadline, which is going to be typically it's the first Friday after classes start. So at that point, they would be finalized. But up until then, there is definitely the mobility to change.
Thank you very much, Margaret.
I'll also say, if you need help with that, you can call us. And we do have a phone number, so it's 828-227-3778. And you are welcome to call us and ask further questions about the process or if there's anything I can do to help with any changes that need to be made.
A follow-up question to something you guys mentioned earlier is, can you explain exactly what exchange meals are again and how they work?
Sure. So what we have are called meal exchanges, and they are equivalents to what we would consider a meal swipe. So if you go into one of our dining halls, one of our residential dining halls, Courtyard Cafe or Brown Lodge, you're going to use a meal swipe. If you go into Chick-fil-A, if you go into Starbucks, if you go into one of our retail locations, we have equivalents in meal exchanges. And so on our unlimited plans, you get one meal exchange per day, and that is equivalent to a swipe that you would use in one of the residential dining halls. If you go into, if you buy a block plan, then those meal exchanges are just one swipe on the block. So if you want to eat three meals on your block plan and you want to go to Chick-fil-A for lunch and you want to have a Starbucks for breakfast and you want to go to Chili's for dinner, then you can use one of those meal swipes based on what those equivalents are. Awesome. They're also on our webpage, dining.wcu.edu, and you'll see the meal exchange tab there. So you can look more specifically at what they are.
Thank you, Margaret.
Mm-hmm.
Next question is back over for residential living. Can freshmen live with upperclassmen?
Yes, they can. Most of our upperclassmen have already gone through room selection, and so hopefully that process was taken care of back in March when we were going through room selection. If for some reason that was missed and you have an upperclassman that the two of you are wanting to room together, I would recommend reaching out to our office sooner rather than later, and we can try our best to accommodate that. If the upperclassman picked a room and somebody else has gone into that room, then we would be having to look at moving the group somewhere else to meet the request. But please reach out to us if that was not taken care of. But by all means, we do have that availability every year. So first-year students and continuing students are welcome to live together.
Thank you, Brian. Another follow-up question, a bit more detailed question for residential living. So my daughter did her housing agreement relatively early and put in her request for a dorm, but didn't know who she wanted to be a roommate. Then she found a roommate who had not completed her housing agreement until later. Will they still have a good chance of getting into the newer residence hall since my daughter did everything early, or will they probably get the older residence hall due to her roommate doing hers later?
So the system is going to look at the one that completed the process first, but I want to be really careful and you know, make no promises, because I know everybody's early is different and what their versions of them are. But please, once again, I'll go back to the fact that our process, the system is going to look at the date that the housing deposit was made, not the date that the room agreement was completed. So know that, yes, it will go by the first one that paid their housing deposit. Know that I also typically remind folks that I know that some folks feel like February was early, and then other folks are feeling like October, September, August of the previous year was early. So know that all of it is, you know, dependent on when that deposit was paid, and that is how the system will go through and assign. But if the deposit truly was paid early, you stand a good chance of getting what your daughter requested.
Thank you very much, Brian. Next question is somewhat orientation and housing based. If my son's band move-in date is the same date as his orientation, what's the best way to make that work? I would suggest signing up for a move-in time slot that does not interact with the orientation. All in-person orientations are going to take place from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. on the dates that you've selected. So if you sign up for a late afternoon or evening move-in slot or an early morning move-in slot, you could potentially make that work. However, that would be my suggestion if your move-in date is on your orientation date for whatever reason. Moving on now back to Catamount Dining. You mentioned job opportunities earlier. Can you tell us about some of the different positions within Catamount Dining that students can have?
Yeah, absolutely. If you look into the website and you start looking at positions, sometimes they're not the most descriptive. So the most general one is a food service worker. You could be a food service worker in a dining hall, in Chick-fil-A. I mean, it's kind of a broad range mixture there, but you know, there's cashiers, line servers, expos in certain locations, cooks, general utility positions, stock positions. We do have peer-to-peer, where you would work with marketing, many barista positions at Starbucks. So if there's anything in the food industry that you're familiar with, we do have a position for you.
Thank you, Eric. Back over to residential living. Are there laundry facilities in every res hall, and how much does it cost?
Yes, there are laundry facilities located in each residence hall, and they are, it is free. Like, you do not need to have quarters or worry about that. I do think that all residence halls now have gone to the high efficiency, correct? So you're going to want to buy, for laundry detergent, you're going to want the high efficiency detergent. It depends on the building in terms of where they're located. So some buildings have like one large area, like, so just one laundry room in the entire, that the whole building shares. Other buildings will have smaller ones on different floors in the residence hall. So it's difficult to answer that kind of across the board, but again, there's no cost associated with laundry.
Thank you, Brian. Next is a follow-up question for Catamount Dining, based on something you mentioned earlier in regards to the mobile ordering app. Can you use the individual brand app, such as the Chick-fil-A app or Chili's app, to order on campus?
No, we do not support those.
Excellent. Easy answer. And another follow-up that nobody has asked yet, but we always get at in-person orientation, regards gift cards. And can you use gift cards for specific locations that are based off of their national brands?
To my knowledge, Starbucks and Chili's are the two locations on campus that you can use a regular gift card app. Yes.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Eric. Moving back to housing, and almost in the same line of thinking, are there full kitchens in any of the residence halls? What are some items that you recommend folks bring with them?
So we do have, and I'm trying to think if every residence hall has a full kitchen, which I think Buchanan is one residence hall that does not. But in most cases, the residence halls do have at least a community kitchen. Some residence halls have multiple kitchens in the building on multiple different floors. In terms of what you can bring and what not to bring, or what, and Brian, you jump into, I recommend a Keurig. I'm a big coffee drinker. You're allowed to have a coffee pot as long as it is like a Keurig, one that doesn't have like a hot plate. A microwave, if you want to bring a refrigerator, a refrigerator freezer combo, maybe work out with your roommate. They bring some things, you bring other things. In terms of specific, we prohibit things like, crock pots and air fryers and pressure cookers. So you're going to want to stay away from rice cookers, some of the real specific type of appliances.
Yep. And I would recommend check out our website, housing.wcu.edu. There is a list of what to bring and what not to bring that will give you some of those good ideas of what to bring, and then we'll tell you what to stay away from that we don't allow in the residence halls. Another thing that I will mention, Brian kind of hit on it, but make sure that you and your roommate are talking and communicating so that you don't end up with two refrigerators, two microwaves taking up precious space that you'll be wanting to use in your room. So make sure that you have that communication and know who's going to bring what, and the kind of set the standard for how you're going to let each other use the different items.
Thank you, guys. Next question is for Catamount Dining. What happens if I run out of DB or exchange meals?
So you're not likely to run out of exchange meals. But if you do, hopefully you select the plan that's right for you and you have enough to get you through the term. But if you run out of declining balance, which is basically a cash balance that you have on your CAT card and you can use at any location, including our pod markets and all of our retail locations, you can add money to your card either through our website or I believe you can add through the portal as well. Maybe you have those options on those two locations, but either way, you have the option to add more declining balance throughout the semester. And that's always something you can do, so you won't run out.
Excellent. Thank you, Margaret. Next, two questions is for residential living. Do both roommates need to register for a time slot to move in? So they move in at the same time, or can they be done separately?
They can be done separately, but please make sure that if you're planning to move in at the same time, both of you still need to make the appointment to sign up for the time slot so that we can have everything ready. So each student individually will need to come through, but there by no means is a requirement that you move in at the same time as your roommate. In fact, it probably works out better for you not to arrive at the same time, just because you'll be trying to get your stuff in, your roommate's trying to get their stuff situated, and sometimes it leaves a little bit extra room if you're not arriving at the same time. But it can be done either way, but no matter what, both need to sign up for a time slot.
Thank you, Brian. Next question is for Brian. How do you recommend we go about nervousness or anxiousness about having a roommate for the first time?
That's a really good question. And it's a very common concern, and it's something that I would imagine a lot of you are probably nervous about, or probably at some point may have some type of roommate conflict. In terms of being nervous about a roommate, like, I would recommend, one, doing exactly what Bryant was just talking about, like making sure that you're communicating and making sure that you're communicating openly with each other, about expectations and things you're going to bring in the room. We have a process very early on, so the first, like pretty much right at the start of the year, the RAs on each floor, so the resident assistant will do roommate agreements, will pass out roommate agreements, and will be expected that each roommate pair kind of come up with those expectations. It's things like what time are are you going to try to go to bed? Are you, how are we going to keep the room clean? How are we going to keep the bathroom clean? What about people stopping by the room, and music levels and things like that, or TV levels? And so make sure that you're communicating very, very openly, very honestly. You have to advocate for yourself in this process. You have to be willing to say, yes, I'm comfortable with this. No, I'm not comfortable with this. And so, again, I think communication is key. I would also say that we have a lot of resources if you are having a difficulty with your room or a difficult time with your roommate. Our case managers, like myself, Evelyn is another case manager. Our building staff, fantastic. We have RAs, we have graduate community coordinators, we have area coordinators. They are all here to help you. You can speak to any one of them. You can speak to anybody in residential living. We don't want you to be unhappy, but we also want you to learn the skills to make it work. Like, we don't want you to just up and move. Like, let's have a conversation. Let's talk about it. Can we make this work? So definitely understand the feeling nervous and being concerned about it, but communicate and we got you. It'll be good.
A direct follow-up to that before we go back to a dining question is, what is a resident assistant? And what types of programs happen in the hall?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. So most, pretty much every single floor has at least one, sometimes in some cases, multiple resident assistants. So a resident assistant, or you'll hear oftentimes hear people say an RA, that is an undergraduate student that is living on your floor. Like, so they're going to classes, you know, just like you, that they're there as a resource to make sure that, you know, things on the hall are in order. You have important information that you need. They're there to give advice, to give guidance. They will serve like duty, where they walk through the building while they're on duty, and they will perform like safety rounds and inspections and make sure that, you know, all the lights are working properly and the facility is where it should be. So that's what, and I think there was a second part to that.
Programming in the hall.
Programming, thank you. Lots of, Bryant mentioned earlier that we are returning to as normal operations. So we're really excited about having in-person programming. It's very difficult to say like what is a typical program. Like RAs, and Josh here was an RA back just a couple years ago, right?
Yeah, like just a hot decade.
One or two, decades. Now, RAs do lots of programs, so sometimes it will be, let's get together and do some sort of craft activity. Let's do a personality test and talk about, you know, what it means. Let's have a pizza party. It's kind of all over the place. We do lots of, programs about, diversity and inclusive excellence. That we try to provide, the RAs all have specific obligations to require a certain number of activities for their students, and we have a lot of those. We missed those this past year a lot. They were all virtual, so we hope that we have a lot of stuff. We expect we'll have a lot of stuff going on in the residence halls in the fall.
Yeah, my all-time favorite program. And if you guys think you're sick of me after having seen me on online orientation and watching these live streams, feel real bad for my buddy Brian, who has been putting up with me since I started working for him as an RA, like I said, like 12, 13 years ago. Yeah, something like that. So if you think you have it bad, this poor guy, he's been dealing with me longer than my wife has. Programs. My all-time favorite program, I used to be the RA for the freshman football players. We did a Madden tournament one year. It was the absolute most nuts and bonkers competitive thing I've ever been a part of. It was crazy.
Yeah, there are definitely video game tournaments, I would say, are one of the things that are popular. Board game nights are also really popular. Mm-hmm. But I remember that program, and I just remember it being like people being very into it, and it was very serious.
We had several noise complaints that came in that
night. No, never.
Moving on now back to Catamount Dining, a series of questions. Will students be considered based on prior experience for certain job positions within the dining? For example, do you need barista experience to work at Starbucks, that kind of thing?
We hire all experience levels. Obviously, having experience is a bonus. If you have no experience, don't worry about that, especially in Starbucks and some other retail locations. There are very extensive training programs to get you guys up to speed and make sure you know you kind of know what you're doing when you get in there. If you have experience, that's always a bonus. If you have lots of experience, let us know, and we'll try and find the best fit for everybody.
Awesome. And the follow-up question to that, you know, you mentioned baristas at Starbucks, folks who've worked at Chick-fil-A's off campus, things like that. Would someone who is a current employee at a different branch apply for a transfer through the company or run through the dining kind of hiring process you mentioned earlier?
So most... We're a licensee, so we hold a licensee. We operate under, you know, a different range of operations. So you would have to apply through us. You would not be able to transfer through that avenue. So yeah, you would have to apply through us. And I'll tell you, Starbucks and Chick-fil-A are the two that fill up the fastest. So if you're looking at a Starbucks or a Chick-fil-A location, you have experience. Go get your application in today. We can set your start date for the fall, and that way that'll secure your spot in there, because once those locations fill up with employees, we try and push people to other locations that will need help. So I would recommend anybody looking for Starbucks or Chick-fil-A, apply quickly.
Excellent. And that's a great reminder for folks who may not have been aware that you can apply for jobs right now for Aramark. There's no reason to wait if you're interested in going ahead and making sure you're not worried about how you're going to get a job when you're sitting in your English 101 class your first day here on campus. You can actually focus on your class instead of worrying about where am I going to get a job later. Another dining question, and this is one I think a lot of folks think about but don't necessarily think to ask. How do parents, guests, or students pay if they don't have a meal plan? Do you guys accept regular payment methods?
Yes, absolutely. We accept cash, credit, debit. We are open to the public, so any visitors, parents, definitely feel free to come and enjoy a meal with your friend or son or daughter or sibling or whoever might be here attending. Yes, so if you don't have a meal plan, absolutely, you can come on in, cash, credit, debit. We'll take care of you.
Thank you very much. Next question is back over for residential living. Which residence halls are designated for freshmen this year? What are the major differences between them? And anything you recommend purchasing for residence hall rooms outside of what we talked about with the food aspect earlier?
So the two first year, the two buildings that only first year students will be allowed to live in are Allen and Albright Benton. So Allen is our newest residence hall currently. It is set up suite style, so it either has a double room with a bathroom inside the room or two private rooms with a bathroom between them. Predominantly, it is the double room setup, but there are some private rooms here. This building is air conditioned and it does have multiple kitchens and significant lobby spaces. Albright Benton is one of our older residence halls. It is set up community bath style, so you will have a hallway with rooms on each side of it, a community bathroom on the back of the hallway, and a community bathroom on the front of the hallway. It does have one community kitchen in it that all students will be able to use. It is unair conditioned, and then I've learned over the last couple of years, I do have to state this, there is also a fairly significant price difference in them. So all of our residence halls are, the price is based on amenity, and so obviously the newer, nicer air conditioned residence hall is going to be more expensive than one of the older as far as Albright Benton would go. For me, the one thing that I would definitely recommend lots of students find to be really a great addition to the room is a rug. So all of our residence hall rooms are just vinyl tile, and so lots of students don't want to get out of bed and step foot on that first thing in the morning. So that would be my recommendation.
And I have to, like Brian knows, I get on a bit of a tangent about this every year. I'm looking you in the eyes here. You can quote me on this one. I'm going to be right, or at least with like 99% accuracy. how pretty your building is, how air-conditioned your building is, has nothing to do with how happy you are going to be. I want you to hear me. And I say that because the students that lived in Albright Benton were extremely happy. The air conditioner, the lack of air conditioning, it's not as big of a deal as you might think. Particularly, you know, fan in, like two fans in the window, one going in, one going out. Now, please understand, I'm not advocating for Albright Benton here. Like, what I'm saying is everybody is just really hung up on the air conditioning and new building and pretty. I'm telling you, they're going to have a great experience. I can't say it enough. The students that lived in Albright Benton were very satisfied. Did everyone love it? No. Not everyone loved Allen. That's how it works. So don't, parents, don't just assume that your student's going to want to live there. I mean, I'm telling you, it's all about the experience. I can't stress it enough. And I don't know if you agree with that, Bryant. I mean, it.
Yep. I've probably seen many of you across the state either in the fall or the spring on WCU On Tour or Spring Blitz. But that is exactly what Brian said is typically my spiel. Every student is different. Every student is going to enjoy a different version of the experience. So, you know, there are only so many rooms in each residence hall. So make your list of preferences, list all of our residence halls if you want to, but don't be devastated if you don't get your first choice, because I can assure you that there will be a piece to where you're assigned to live that you'll really love in the end and give it a shot. That also gives me the kind of the segue into, Brian mentioned a little earlier in the question about living with a roommate. So parents, listen to me, love you dearly, I don't mean anything by this, but those preferences need to be completed by your student, especially the roommate matching questions. I recognize that you may think that you know your student, but nothing is worse than the system to match up exactly on what those preferences and those matching questions were. And then in August and September, we have an upset student and they say, oh, I never filled that out. My parents filled that out for me. So please, please let the student, I would even say privately, answer those questions. They're not deep, in-depth, extremely personal, but they will help us to match them with the best roommate, the best building that they would prefer to live in.
And I'm telling you, I'm going to be right on this one. Like, so you can come back and you can remind me I told you this. And I know you're sitting there going, there's no way that, yes, definitely Alan. Come on, Josh, you lived in Scott. Back in that, like, Scott is no longer with us. It was not air conditioned. How much did everyone love living in Scott?
Adored it. And nobody wanted to live in Scott initially. And so everybody was grumpy for about 24 hours. And then, sure enough, when you started making friends, you learned, and it was easy to make friends there because you kept your door open because there was no air conditioning. So you had the fan blowing. So that, number one, is an easy way to meet people. Met people walking to and from the bathroom. I mean, like, it was something that I enjoyed that very, very much. To quote a song that most of our viewers would probably consider an oldie, you can't always get what you want, but if you try sometimes, you might find you get what you need. So keep that philosophy in mind when thinking about both choosing housing and even choosing dining plans as well. As we wind down our program, we do have about 5 or 6 minutes left before we reach the end of our time. Did want to ask our friends over in Catamount Dining, do you guys have any sustainability initiatives for food waste or things that you're highlighting to be more eco-friendly?
I think me and Margaret are kind of going to tag team this one. So last year, our dining services were extremely streamlined as far as, you know, not so much the food, but just the overall experience. Everything in a very affordable styrofoam container. All those containers are going to go away. We'll be introducing a reusable to-go container that you can get a clean one when you show up to the dining hall. Take it with you, and then, you know, when you bring it back, you can get another clean one. So that is on the forefront for us coming up here this fall. just being the fact that we are very aware of what we had to do this past year, and there was a pretty large investment to get this program going, and I think it's going to be a great improvement on the sustainability side and the enjoyment of your meals and everything like that. And
yeah, so we also have introduced into our dining program paper straws that are more eco-friendly and intended to be ultimately compostable, or being able to go back into biodegradable, you know, types of solutions. We also are very, very focused on waste management, both from the point of sale where the students are plating their food, but also in our production and along the lines of just overall awareness of how to decrease waste through food consumption. We are focused on hiring a sustainability ambassador next fall in the marketing department for Catamount Dining. And so that position is actually going to be posted and available within the next, I would say, 4 to 6 weeks. And so that's a position that we're looking to fill. We really hope to fill that, obviously, with a student, an undergraduate student. And that position is really going to be focused on how to improve our sustainability program overall and to implement new initiatives that we have, you know, of mind to implement, including a Catamount Dining recycling program. So that's probably the top initiative going into this next year, is to find that person and then to move our program forward.
A final question for Catamount Dining is one I want to make sure we get and don't miss out on. It's a two-parter. Are there a lot of vegetarian, vegan options for students? And what should students do if they have a food allergen and are worried about availability in on-campus locations?
So Eric and I can both speak to this, but this is clearly something, anytime we're presented with a student that has a food allergy and or diet restrictions, we want to make sure that you know how to contact us. You know, our numbers are posted online. You can reach us at any point in time to help you navigate through our operations and our dining facilities. And we really are focused on trying to communicate about food allergens. We obviously feed the masses, and so we can't say that our locations are allergen-free or gluten-free, but we do have a very strong emphasis on both training our staff, making sure that the options we have are plentiful for vegan, vegetarian, and allergies, and that we continue to communicate about how to find them. So I don't know if you have something to add there.
Yeah, I would add that, you know, all of our national brands, their menus are the same as they are wherever you are right now. So whatever allergen or dietary needs those locations support, we do as well. As far as our all you care to eat facilities, the dining halls, we do have vegan options daily, vegetarian options daily, gluten-friendly, prepared without gluten items that you can get at any time. Sometimes you may have to request it. The one thing I'd like to emphasize here is communication. I just want to say that if you're an incoming student or you have a son or daughter who is coming in to Western Carolina this fall that has an allergy or a dietary restriction, the best way to do that is to communicate with myself, Margaret, anybody on our team, and we're going to take the time and make sure that everybody feels comfortable. As Margaret said, we are here to feed the masses, but every one of you is very important to us, and we want to make sure that your experience is not different from anybody else's. So please, communication. Don't be here for 2 months and then come to one of our dining service advisory board meetings and say, I have this allergy and I can't find anything to eat, because come find us, come talk to us. We're here to support you. We are wonderful people and we want you to be happy. That is our goal. So please open the lines of communication with us. We're gonna work hand in hand with y'all to make sure everybody feels comfortable.
And I would say happy and healthy. And lastly, on our website, under our locations and menus, you'll find all of the menu items for all of our locations. They also have little icons there that'll say vegan, vegetarian, or gluten-free. And so there are identification processes that we have in place that can be identified through our website, and that is always something that's available.
Thank you both very much. Any kind of final advice that any of the four of you have for incoming students or their parents as they prepare to join us this fall? Or some this summer with summer learning programs?
So my piece would be use the resources that are out there. I think we've all mentioned calling us if you have questions. Use the website. Use all of our social media. So we're on Facebook, Instagram, all sorts of options there. But get excited. We are looking forward to having you here in Cullowhee very, very soon.
Yeah, I mean, I would echo a little bit of what Brian said. Like, just be prepared to for a lot of opportunities, and we really want you to take advantage of those, and we're going to do our absolute best to, one, communicate all of our different events and options that are going on, but we also want you, we want you to really engage. I think that a lot of us have probably learned over the last year that we just miss being around people. And we miss the community, and we are definitely going to be trying to bring that back. And so I would say really pay attention. Again, you know, engage with our social media, be reading your email, look at flyers on campus. We're going to be promoting these events. And again, we can't force you. We really, really want you to engage. The statistics show that if you get engaged in something, just something, that you are much more likely to succeed, do well academically, graduate from the institution, and just overall satisfaction. So just really come here with an open mind and ready to have a lot of fun, but also have a lot of opportunities that we really want you to capitalize on.
Thank you, guys. Anything from Catamount Dining?
Yeah, a little bit of, you know, what these folks over here are saying is we're very excited to kind of get as back to normal as possible. If you've never lived in the area or never even maybe been here yet, Western Carolina is a beautiful place, lots of like-minded people, and it's very hard to be upset here. I'm telling you, it's an absolute dream to live in this area of the world, and to go to be able to attend a university in an area like this is wonderful. So the one thing I think we've all stressed is communication. You know, you have to communicate with us, with residential living. We are not a mind reader. We're not psychic. So please, don't be afraid to speak up and ask the right questions and seek the things that you want. There's nothing wrong with that at all. And on the engagement part, go out there, be engaged, try new things. We only live once, and this is going to be a great experience for everybody.
Yeah, I'd say we're going to be ramped up next fall, really excited and just looking forward to welcoming everyone into our Catamount Dining family. We're all food people. We love food. We love serving you, and we love welcoming you into our community. So please let us know how we can enrich your experience with us, and we are going to be listening and looking forward to having you all come on campus.
Thank you very much, Margaret. Eric. Bryant, Brian, thank you all for joining us tonight. A couple of quick notes for housekeeping from orientation item. We did get one question tonight. When do our classes get assigned? And the answer is they should already have been assigned. Whether you are registered for the online-only program or the hybrid program where you're going to join us in person in August, you're required to complete the online orientation that opened up last Monday. So it's been open now for about 9-10 days. So please take advantage, log into that, get those requirements knocked out. That's where you're going to get your class schedule. That's where you're going to learn how to add and drop classes, learn rules, resources, expectations, things like that. like that. My staff is always available. Every single one of my 14 student staff members has office hours that run from 8 in the morning until 9 in the evening. So check out the discussion boards, check out orientation.wcu.edu to take advantage of that, learn a little bit more about that. We also have socials that go on nearly every single day. Today was actually the first day we didn't have a social, Monday to Friday, since we opened the program. So lots of opportunity to get involved, to meet new people, to try some fun new things. And if you haven't thought about it to this point yet, think about joining us for in-person orientation in August. We'd love to have you join us. We do still have some capacity restrictions, and we are getting close to maxing out every available session. So if you're on the fence thinking about in-person orientation, we'd love to have you come hang out with us. We're not going to talk business at all. We're going to be focused on making friends, making memories, getting to know campus a little bit better. It's going to be a great way to get to know people and break the ice of becoming a student here at WCU. For all of our panelists, we appreciate you tuning in tonight. I'd be in big trouble if I didn't wish my 9-month pregnant wife and my 4-year-old daughter a good evening. I will be home soon. I love you very much, Lily and Brittany. And Oliver, hopefully you're not here yet. You wait until after the live stream's over. But thank you all for tuning in tonight. We'll see you here next week again for orientations live stream number 3 next Tuesday from 6 to 7. Thanks for tuning in. And as always, go Cats!